Good morning and welcome to the 18th meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. Our first item of business today is a decision to take items 6 and 7 in private. Are we all agreed? Thank you very much. And we now turn to our next item of business, which is an evidence session on Social Security spending forecasts with the Scottish Fiscal Commission, who are all in the room with us today. And I welcome to the meeting Dame Susan Rice, DBE, who is the Chair, and Commissioner Professor David Ulph, and Head of Social Security and Public Funding for the Fiscal Commission, Claire Marduk. Good morning. And before I invite Dame Susan Rice to make some opening remarks, I'd like to take this opportunity to thank Dame Susan for her leadership of the Scottish Fiscal Commission. As we note, your term of office is coming to an end. It has been a pleasure to work with you, and the Commission's forecasts are integral to the Committee's ability to scrutinise the Scottish Government's spending on social security. And I'll now invite you to make a few opening remarks, please.
Convener, thank you very much for those kind words, and even more so, thank you for the invitation to come and discuss our most recent forecasts. I'll say a few words about the current economic context before turning to our social security forecasts. The outlook for the Scottish economy is much more uncertain than in our last forecast in December 2021. The Russian invasion of Ukraine, rising energy prices, and further global supply chain disruptions on the back of China's response to COVID have led to a very challenging economic outlook. Rising inflation is creating a cost of living crisis for many households. For those households in work, we forecast real earnings to fall. Our forecasts expect inflation to peak at around or nearly 9% in the last quarter of this year as the October energy price cap increase comes in. For those receiving Social Security payments, our current forecasts are based on an increase of 7.5% in April 2023, but the exact uprating will depend on this September's CPI inflation figure. The effects of inflation will be felt particularly by lower income households who spend more of their money on essentials and can't easily cut back on savings or discretionary spending to cover rising costs. This economic outlook feeds through into the Scottish Government's funding position for the resource spending review. Overall, we're expecting total funding to drop slightly in real terms for the next 3 years before increasing only slightly. Social Security spending will account for a growing share of the resource budget. Right now, the Social Security accounts for around 10%. By 2026-27, we expect it to have increased to around 14%. A reminder here that we only forecast spending on the payments that are made to people, not the administrative costs or wider implications of Social Security spending. Since December, our forecasts of Social Security spending for 2026-27 have increased by nearly £1 billion. This increase is because of higher inflation alongside the inclusion of Scottish Government policy announcements, such as the increase in the Scottish child payment to £25 a week. Also, in our previous forecasts, we didn't include Scottish Government commitments on Social Security, where crucial details on those payments were still to be decided. The forecasts we've just produced are supporting a four-year spending review, and within that four-year period, the Scottish Government has committed to replacing the devolved payments still administered by DWP. Through the devolution of winter fuel payments and the introduction of replacement payments for carer's allowance, attendance allowance, and industrial injuries disablement benefits. So we've now included indicative forecasts of additional spending for these payments coming over the next 4 years, in total adding nearly £350 million to our forecasts by 2026-27. Now, some of you may have been doing your maths, and if you were, you'll see that there's still an increase of just over £300 million, which I haven't yet explained. This increase is the result of data updates, modelling changes, and changes to our assumptions. The most significant changes relate to personal independence payment, which is being replaced by the adult disability payment, and reflect changes in the data available from DWP. Overall, Social Security spending is expected to increase and to be higher than the funding received from the UK government. By 2026-27, we expect nearly £1.3 billion to be spent above the funding received. We call out as realistic a picture as we can of what will need to be spent on Social Security in the future to help the government plan its budgets to ensure sufficient funding has been allocated to its Social Security priorities. These payments are demand-led, and the spending in future years is determined by policies the Scottish Government has already set in place. When our forecasts for Social Security spending are added to the government's own plans for health and social care spending, the funds left for other portfolios are constrained. Once adjusted for inflation, funding for these other areas falls substantially for the first 3 years of the spending review and is 8% below current levels by 25-26. In 26-27, funding is expected to be 5% below this year in real terms. And if I could, to complement your opening comments, just finish on a personal note and say that it has been a genuine privilege for me to lead the Commission over the last 8 years, five of those under a statutory framework, but we did start in 2014. And believe it or not, I've actually enjoyed and genuinely valued our regular engagement with several parliamentary committees, not least this very important one. And I think we've all come a long way, so I thank you. And now we're very happy to take some questions.
Thank you very much for your remarks there. We are going to turn to questions from members now. We have a few themes to explore. The first theme is comparison with December forecasts, and thank you very much for setting the scene as you just did in your opening remarks. I'm going to turn to questions from my colleague Paul McLennan first, who will be followed by Jeremy Balfour.
Paul. Thanks, convener, and morning, panel. The first question, you kind of touched on it, is which Scottish Government policies are having the greatest impact on the forecasts and which are having the least impact?
I think mimicking what one thing we said after the December budget and after our report then is that bringing in the forecast for ADP, which is still being sort of trialed, if you will, in certain areas just now, but it is in the process of coming in fully, that is a huge benefit in financial terms. So that is adding significantly. And a reminder that ADP, and there are several other disability benefits and some other benefits, are also index-linked so that they rise with inflation, which is appropriate for the recipients. I mean, that obviously makes sense, but it also means that they grow, and that's why we've looked at that concern about, what's the spend now and what will the spend be. And there are other factors that have come into the growth. I don't know if David or Claire, I don't want to say too much.
Some of the factors that are work here are there is about a third of a billion increase in the ADP forecast because of the data and modelling assumptions. Higher inflation has about another 0.2 billion. And these indicative forecasts we've made of new payments still to be launched as about another 0.3 billion. So it's a combination of different factors at work here.
Okay. I suppose one question you touched as well, Dame Susan, was about the inflationary outlook. I don't think anybody would have forecast that they went to 9%, even with some of the geopolitical events that kind of went on. I think that's been higher than was forecast before. I don't know what your outlook then is, and I know it's a crystal ball type of thing, but where do you kind of see inflation? Listening to Radio 4 this morning, and we're talking about the various things this morning, saying is this a blip, or is this something that's going to be going on for the next year or two, because there's the food supply issues and so on. And where do you kind of see that going? And I know it's hard to hold you to this one, but if inflation in the next year, is this something you would see in the next year or two almost peaking, or do you see this as an issue going forward for the, as I said, maybe beyond that?
Well, it's a really important question, because the importance of it is it's not so much the figure that's attached to inflation, although the number is, it attracts our attention right now because it's quite high, but it's how long does it become entrenched or not? And that's the real issue. We're not in a position to to say, so our central forecast is that by the end of this year, with the next price cap increase for energy, we think it'll come close to 9%. The inflation in April was even a little higher than that, but you know, we don't yet know, so that's one thing. The other thing that I think is important to say is that with the Chancellor's package, particularly the one from late May, the additional funding being made available mainly to low-income families. Now, that isn't everyone who receives Social Security benefits is not low-income, but a lot of people are, and they struggle more. They will be made whole possibly for this year, so they won't. They will have enough to cover the increase in those costs for food and for energy this year, and that's a general and an average statement. But if inflation becomes entrenched, then you know therein lies a potential problem.
So that's something we've got to be very aware of, obviously.
We have to. David, were you going to come in on that? Yes, sorry.
Well, basically, just to amplify what Susan has said, that in our forecast report, we said that one of the big risks was this question: what's the shape of inflation over the next few years? In our forecast, we're forecasting it will fall fairly rapidly back down towards about 2%. But that's a big area of uncertainty. And what's going on here is that, as Susan said in her opening remarks, a lot of the inflation we've seen is driven by cost push inflations coming from availability of energy and other inputs. If that turns into a wage price spiral, that's where there's a risk of it becoming more endemic and lasting. But if it doesn't become endemic, then we don't see any other big pressures driving up prices. It doesn't mean the prices are going to fall, it just means they will stay high. But there's nothing else we see at the moment which is necessarily going to have the same rate of increase as we've seen over the last year or so.
Okay. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Jeremy?
Thank you, and good morning to the panel. I wonder if you could just help me, going forward, in regard to when you're looking at your forecast, which is easier, harder to forecast? If it is a benefit that's going to lots of people, so the winter payment goes to the most people, I think, in Scotland, something like AGP, the new DP, is a lot, you know, a much more available thing. So when you're forecasting, and as a committee, perhaps you could guide us a bit, and what other ones we should be looking at for you as you predict, which are the easier ones and which are the harder ones?
So I'll give a general answer, but then again turn to my colleagues. So again, come back to ADP, because that is just bigger and it covers a large population. Something like the winter heating that is just to come, you know, over the next few years, if there are no changes to that benefit, then the funding comes with it. So you don't need to worry, even though more people, I don't know the numbers, Claire might know the numbers or David, but the difference is where in Scotland, both sort of paying attention to the Social Security Charter and what the government's priorities are, a lot of the benefits have expanded in the sense of the way people can apply for them, in the way that they're advertised and people are invited in. The process has been made more user-friendly. The renewal process has been made more user-friendly. So there are a lot of reasons why possibly more, a bigger population may come in for individual benefits here and may apply for them and may well qualify for them and may well stay in them longer. So a little hard for me to pinpoint others, but I don't know, Claire, do you have a particular other one too?
Well, I suppose I can just add that in terms of the number of people that are being supported by a payment, that doesn't directly correlate to how difficult or easy it is to forecast. So the pension age winter heating assistance, which will replace winter fuel payments, without sounding too confident about our forecast, I think is probably one of the easiest ones to forecast, because it goes to almost everybody over a certain age and it's fixed payment amounts. And as Susan has said, the most difficult thing to forecast is when you have these policy changes, particularly around how a payment is delivered, which is harder for us to quantify. If a payment amount is changed, that's easier. So it's where these changes are made that I think the greatest attention needs to be paid, and particularly on ADP because of the scale of the changes which are being made and the scale of the payment in terms of total value. A relatively small forecast error here from us can actually amount to quite large amounts in the government's budget.
Thank you, and that's very helpful. And just a quick follow-up. When you're doing your forecasting, say around ADP, and there is a divergence between the UK government and the Scottish government, what information do you need from both governments around that? And do you take a view whether that is a significant divergence that would then have to be paid for by Scottish government, or whether that can be mopped up within the UK budget?
Well, we do try to identify which elements of the reform are purely Scottish elements. And once we've identified that, it's clear from the way the fiscal framework works that that spending will fall on the Scottish government's budget, not on the UK. So there won't be any BGAs that come along with that. So what we did with ADP was we first of all tried to forecast what we call the PIP baseline, which is what would have happened had we persisted with PIP in the rest of the UK. Then we tried to systematically build up our understanding of what all the various reforms the Scottish government was making to the way in which it would be delivered, even though the payment levels were the same. The way it was being delivered was going to change. And we identified about 12 different factors of work there, and we went through and systematically examined each one of those. We have no data to go on until the policy is actually implemented. We've got no data to go on. So essentially, there's a lot of judgment involved in this, but we cross-checked our assumptions with a range of other experts in forecasting Social Security to make sure that they thought our assumptions were broadly sensible assumptions. We put a lot of effort into cross-checking this.
That's very helpful. And just of those 12 areas, are they controversial, or is there a general feeling that these are the 12 areas that we should be looking at? Or I know you're not involved in politics, but at some point, presumably, it will have to be a judgment call by both governments in regard to that. But so far, do you think it's fairly clear that there is an agreement that these 12 areas that you've looked at are agreed by both governments?
Well, these are reforms that have been announced by the Scottish Government. So I don't think there's any debate about whether those are in or out. They are there. I think one important point to make at this stage is that when you make these types of reforms, it's not just a one-off effect on the level of payment. Some of these effects persist over very long periods of time. So if you make it easier for people to be put onto the ADP in the first place, then once they're on that, if you extend the length of time in which they remain on the benefit, if you make it easier for them to go through a reassessment process, anything you do at the outset persists for many, many years. So it's the fact that it's growing, that growth will continue for quite a period of time after all of these reforms have actually started to come into play. So we can't say exactly what that rate of growth will be, but don't think the level's going to stay at the level in 2027-28. There are factors in these reforms that will cause that to carry on growing.
Could I just add on the UK, because you asked about the UK government policy changes earlier, and we do look at when the UK government is making a change which will affect Scottish social security spending, we do take that into account. So at the moment, if the UK government changes PIP, because the majority of people are still being paid by DWP, those changes will have an effect in Scotland. So we take those into account, and we can discuss that with DWP and with the OBR. And similarly, changes which are made to universal credit, which might affect eligibility for payments such as the Scottish Child Payment, we take those into account as well.
Thank you. Thank you, Gwena.
Thank you very much. And before we move on to our next set of questions, which is around about the potential gap in funding that's been looked at, I think that what you've just described at the moment tells us that it's a very iterative process. It is constantly changing in terms of the data that has been given at different times by different sections of government, but also by what's going to come out of the pilots and then what's going to actually come out of the review that's going to take place. So it is a very iterative process, and I think it's very important that this committee has close links with yourselves in terms of how we scrutinise that going forward. And it does show from December just how drastically things can change when we take all of these things on board. So thank you for that. Our next theme is around about a gap in funding. I'm going to go back to Paul McLennan, who will start us off on that, and then over to Miles Briggs. Paul?
Yeah, thanks, Kavina. You've kind of touched on it, because I think one of the things that was talked about was obviously you talked about how uncertainty would reduce as payments were launched. And I think we've obviously seen situations since December, and I think Dame Susan talked about it, that's now changed. And it comes back to the point that the convener made, is, I suppose it's from our analysis point of view, what's almost like the feed-in time, if we're talking around about how things have changed, how early should we be engaging with yourself in that process in terms of, rather than us coming to this, and it's almost a shock, should we be engaging at an earlier stage with yourself in terms of the impact that's going to have? Because even from December to June, that's changed quite substantially. Should we have been engaging with you earlier rather than at this stage? So it's more on about the process. You've also obviously indicated that the uncertainty obviously has increased rather than reduced since then, but it's more about where we should be analysing it and working with yourself in that regard.
Yeah, that's an interesting question, because we obviously welcome any inquiries or contact. The way we approach and others approach for developing a forecast is usually around a 10-week period of time. So in a way, we need to wait. There are various elements. It's not that we sit there and say, tomorrow we'll do it. It does take time, and it is an iterative process. Also, there are reports of data. So data for some areas come out annually, monthly, quarterly, weekly, whatever. And our forecasts change as we are able to bring in more up-to-date data. So sometimes we're asked, why are you a little different from the OBR in a particular place? And it's because they've had data, or even the Scottish Government, in some cases in the RSR, will have used December data because that's the practice, the protocol, whereas we will use the most up-to-date data. So it's hard for me to say there's a point in time when it would be helpful, but if you have questions in your deliberations, I'd urge you, presumably through a letter from the convener, to come to the Commission and at least say you're concerned about something, and we'll see what we can do.
Yeah, because I think the point you made, because it's almost taking a point in time, and that point in time can change very quickly.
Yeah.
And obviously the analysis we're based in is on that point of time when circumstances might have changed, even within the 6 months we're talking about. So, yeah, and I think that's my deliberation we need to have within the committee, and obviously I think with the Scottish Government as well, in terms of how do we analyse that. So, yeah, that's... Thank you for that.
Yeah.
It also goes back to the question of the scale of spending.
Yeah.
Because even relatively small changes in EDP start to add up to tens of millions, if not hundreds of millions of pounds. So it depends a lot on the benefit. For relatively small benefits, some degree of uncertainty is not going to change the overall funding that much. For ADP, even small things change it by very large numbers.
Okay. That's maybe something, and I'll raise that at the end, but how we analyse that, because you're right, because I think you mentioned at the start that the changes were, some of the modelling was 300 million, inflation was a certain part of it, and so on. So, yeah, these changes, even though you're saying small, can have a major impact. We are talking £200-300 million that can make a huge difference. Yep. But that's maybe something that we need to take up and how we analyse that going forward. Yep. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Paul. Over to yourself, Miles.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Thank you for joining us this morning. I wanted to follow on from that line of questioning with regards to uncertainty around the launch of some of the new benefits. And, for example, the forecasts around disability benefits, which you outlined in December, is there more clarity since they've been launched around cost predictions?
Great. Yeah.
We would like to sit here and say yes, but I'm afraid the short answer is no. So the Scottish Child Payment launched last year, and Social Security Scotland have published some statistics so far on the number of children receiving payment, but they're not in the form that is comparable to what we have from DWP at the moment, so we haven't been able to take those into account in our forecast. This means that all our disability payment forecasts are still very much based on assumptions and judgments. We're going to be working with Social Security Scotland over the summer to discuss the data that they have, what they can make available, and hopefully, as a spoiler, when we speak to you in September, after we published our forecast evaluation report, which will evaluate child disability payment spending last year, we'll be able to say what we can say in terms of whether the forecast that we made for last year was accurate, whether the things that we expected to see in terms of changes in the number of children applying and number of children being successful has been seen, or whether the data isn't available in the form that we need yet.
That's great. That's helpful. Thank you. And my other question was with regards to the Scottish Government spending review. Did you see any clarity in that around where this funding gap potentially will be found? And I think we're all looking at what was a predicted cut in local government funding of around 7%. Do you think that's where funding is likely to come from?
So could I just say something in general about the spending review? I sort of personally believe, and I think my colleagues agree, that this was a really useful thing to have done. And I, in another committee, use the word brave as well, because it does lay things out. But for the government, knowing that it has the commitments and the priorities in the area that this committee looks at, and that these numbers grow, and it's hard to know what the future holds, by doing the spending review, it forced the discipline of saying, if using our forecasts for funding as well as for spending, if those numbers were all today's, the numbers that we published were the numbers, they project how they would have a balanced budget. I say they, some of you, it's the government, it's all of you. And that legally is the requirement to balance the budget. Now, if more funding comes in over time, that's a place to start. That's a concrete platform to say, this would have been balanced, but we have more funding, so maybe we give some to local government, or maybe they would say, we haven't really sort of done it for child poverty, and we want to add more there. You know, the decision process will be more effective having done the spending review. But the spending review is basically showing, I think it's roughly an 8% cut on average across areas that are outside of health and social care spending and social security. So that's what you have to do, is, you know, move your priorities.
Thank you. You've obviously been doing these reports for a number of years and seeing this, where you must have also seen every year local government and other budgets are facing that cut. From your experience across other committees where you're giving evidence, you know, is there more which can be found within these budgets, though, do you think, to be able to meet that shortfall?
So that's beyond our pay grade, if you will. So we don't, as I think you know, but it's always good to remind ourselves and others, we don't involve ourselves and develop the expertise to consider policies, potential policies. When a new policy is announced, we then cost it because it is an announced policy. So we wouldn't come up with speculative, more could be done here or there. That's really the government's job.
Could I maybe just add, going back to your first question about understanding the spending review, one thing that has happened over the last couple of forecasts is we've gone into far more detail about how exactly the government is going to balance its budget from year to year. So we've had a lot of discussion about other sources of income that might be available to the government to get a year-on-year balance in the budget, and that I think has been a big development in the relationships between us and the Scottish Government. We are interrogating areas that had previously not been looked at before, so we're just bringing a degree of transparency to how the government thinks it will be able to manage some of these fluctuations in spending and in revenue and funding from year to year. So that's another area where I think we're making big steps forward.
Yeah, that's helpful. Thank you. Thanks, Kamina.
Thank you very much. And we'll move on to questions with regards to indicative forecasts. And I'll bring the deputy convener in to start us off, Natalie.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to the panel. You've touched this morning on some of the matters that are and will continue to impact these forecasts, such as inflation, Scottish Government spending and the cost of living crisis. But can you advise how uncertain these forecasts are, and can you expand on any other areas that may impact the forecasts?
Maybe if you want to start off.
Okay, there are different areas of uncertainty here. We've touched on a lot of the areas of uncertainty around ADP. The indicative forecasts have a different degree of uncertainty or a different source of uncertainty, because we know some elements of what the policy is going to be, but we still don't know the full elements of the policy. Normally we would only cost a policy once we know in quite considerable detail what the elements are going to be about launch date, how it's actually going to be delivered, what efforts will be put into promoting the benefit, and so on. All of these factors we want to know at some level of detail before we produce the costing. But we felt that in order to be helpful for the spending review, we couldn't just say these policies are not known well enough for us to say anything. That would have been just as misleading as saying something. So we decided to develop these indicative forecasts, which try to help the government understand something about the range of spending that might be involved with these policies that are coming under that heading. Okay. So there is a degree of uncertainty there which is different from other areas, because we felt it was helpful to produce forecasts not fully understanding all the level of detail that we would normally want to understand.
Okay, thank you. One of the areas around uncertainty I know is UK government funding, and we can see in the report that the Scottish Government funding from the UK falls up to the period 24-25, and capital funding is decreasing over the next 3 years. So I understand that social security funding works a little bit differently in that we receive BGAs based on the UK payments. But that means that UK government decisions on areas of social security are going to dramatically impact the Scottish government's position. So I'm just wondering, Claire, I know you touched on this slightly earlier, can you expand on how the SFC consider the impacts on forecasts depending on the level of spending from the UK government?
Okay, so it's a good question. And I think it's part of the fiscal devolution that the Scottish Government has, that its budget is inherently very linked to what the UK Government does in terms of spending, and also tax revenue as well. So when we're forecasting the Scottish social security spending, we, as I said earlier, we do take account of UK Government policy where it's changes to things like PIP or changes to universal credit. And those will feed through both in terms of when the payments are still being administered by DWP, but almost more importantly, through the block grant adjustments. And if the UK government makes a change to, say, PIP spending in England and Wales, that will directly affect how much the Scottish government receives in funding. So that's the sort of social security element of it. And we do then compare that to... we compare our Scottish social security forecast to the block grant adjustments, in terms of our social security commentary, and where we sort of show a funding gap here, it's not necessarily a gap in real terms of it not being funded, it's just the gap between what's directly received and what the Scottish Government is spending. And then separately, there's the wider question of the whole budget, where there's the block grant is a big component of Scottish Government funding still, even with the tax-raising powers being devolved, and that's, again, directly related to how much the UK Government is spending in other devolved areas. And so we do include, we set out what the Scottish Government's funding looks like over the next 5 years and how dependent and how that's changing depending on what the UK Government is doing. And that is a big area of uncertainty, which we discussed more with the Finance Committee, but the UK government can change its spending plans in year, as we have seen with just the announcement from the Chancellor a few weeks ago that did result in some consequentials for the Scottish government. So the government is managing its budget in year, which is very important, and also over multiple years. So it's challenging for you all to be scrutinising what's happening, as well as it is for us to be forecasting when this change is being made all the time.
Absolutely, absolutely. All right, thank you, Convener. No further questions on this theme.
Thanks very much for that. We'll now move on to questions from Pam Duncan-Glancy and then followed back by Miles Briggs again. Pam, thanks.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. Thank you for the information you've given in advance, but also for the questions you've answered so far. It's really helpful, particularly for someone like me who finds some of this, the detail of it, quite complicated. So it's really helpful to have it set out in the way that you have in advance, so thank you. I just want to explore a little bit more about some of the options available to the government. So some of this will touch on, of course, the forecast and a little bit possibly on the gaps in the previous kind of thematic discussion. Obviously, you've set out today that some of the funding decisions around social security will mean that the pressures on other areas are significant. Could you set out your view on what other options were available to the government to balance the books on social security in this way?
Oh, what other? Well, so they've put out a plan. The government has only so many levers to use, basically. So borrowing is limited. There's the reserve, and they've put out a plan for how they would, draw on the reserve and in what. A schedule for doing that. So what else? I don't know. David?
Well, I think one answer is go back to the answer I gave before, that if you look at some of these indicative forecasts for new areas of social security, what happens is because we've forecast what will happen under the spending review, that means that the government will have to understand that if it wants to implement further policy reform in those areas. At the moment, there is no funding within the funding profile for that. So it will have to think about how does it prioritise that within the areas where it can make other decisions. So we're not saying it can't make those things, we're saying it can make further changes. But it now understands that within the funding profile of it, we've given it, within the funding envelope, there will have to be other areas that will have to be accommodate those spending decisions. So I think that's where we've been helpful to the Scottish Government. As I said before, there's a lot of details about how the government manages budget from year to year, what other sources of funding it might have available. And we're getting greater transparency on what it can do in those areas. But there's a lot of uncertainty around that area as well.
Thank you. And actually, just to pick up on that point, Professor, you mentioned earlier about the changing relationship. I think you said it's been a bit more transparent on what other funding options it has available. Can you give us any more detail about those kind of conversations that you've been having?
Well, the issues are around how it manages the reserve, what its plans are for spending into the reserve, what its plans are for drawing down to the reserve. There was an assumption in the 21 budget that there was £620 million the government would find from other sources. We then interrogated those £620 million sources. We found that two of them have generated around half the 620 million. One source of funding to cover the gap in the last budget was ScotWind, but now the government has decided not to use ScotWind to cover the 620 million. It wants to use that to put in to cover funding gaps in the earlier years of the spending review. So we've got some understanding now of where the ScotWind funding is going to go, how much is going to go in 1 year, how much is going to go into the other year. So this transparency process, I think, is it's a conversation. They're doing their job, we're doing our job, and we're trying to help them understand how they can or cannot manage the budget, the community. And our job is to say whether we think their assumptions are reasonable. That's the judgment we have to come to. We came to the decision that we were broadly reasonable, which is quite a qualified statement to make.
Thank you. I appreciate that. And I guess that leads me on nicely to my next question, which is about the kind of broad reasonableness of the assumptions. And I note that you mentioned earlier that aspects like launch date, promotion, and approach to benefits can add to the uncertainty around the cost. How much information have you had in your discussions with the government about any likelihood for changes to policy within the period that you have? I note in the submission that you gave us, you've said that you assumed that it would be on a kind of reasonably fewer changes to policy in the next period, and that they had considered that reasonable. We're obviously keen as a committee to understand what opportunities there could be through things like the review of ADP. Do you get any sense of any kind of timescales or thought process from the government about changes to those things so that we could start to look at that in advance in terms of where the money would come from?
I think it's ADP. I mean, it's a little bit early because that is still being trialled in a way, and I think the government will look to see what it learns from that. Where we have made some general assumptions, we talked about the four payments which will come in over the next 4 years, you know, finally come over to become Scottish payments. And we've assumed, at least for three of them, one is just coming over as is, the winter fuel payment, but the other three, so we've made assumptions. The reason we call it indicative forecast is we have a little information, but we don't have all of that information. Mm-hmm. So we've assumed that probably the similar approach to advertising, to notifying society that these benefits are available. So this Social Security here has invited in, it's opened up that communication more so than one would have seen previously under the DWP benefits. And we're assuming that same approach will apply to these new ones. So we don't know for sure. So, you know, it's all, somebody used the word iterative before. This is iterative for you, and it is for us, and I think indeed for the government as well, as it learns over time. It will take some years till the data accumulates, till the patterns show, and till the government sees what is really effective in terms of its desired outcomes.
Thank you. And the point about the iterative process, I think, that the convener made earlier is really, really important, I think, for all of this, so that we can see it going forward. Just one follow-up from that. And forgive me if it's in the detail you've given us and I've missed it. What assumptions are you making about uptake of benefits? Are you applying a particular percentage uptake assumption?
Oh, gosh, that varies very much from benefit to benefit, and actually we make judgments based on how easy it might be for people to apply. Mm-hmm. You know, has the process changed? Has it been easier? When do individuals need to review or be reviewed? And is that an easy process or not? So all of these factors come into whether people will take it up. We've also had some just conjecture around inflation, if that has an impact on some households and puts greater strain, some that might not have bothered to apply for a benefit might do so. So a lot of factors. Again, David, you want to?
Well, just one point to add is that what matters for the number of people ultimately getting benefit is two factors: entitlement, and then there's the take-up rate. The problem we face is that for a lot of these benefits, it's not even clear what the entitlement is. So what we sometimes do is we just forecast the numbers while we're trying to break it down into this is entitlement, this is the take-up rate. For some benefits, we do try to do that, break it down into entitlement and take-up rate. But it's not just take-up that drives this is also entitlement. But Claire, do you want to?
I could perhaps give you some specific figures as examples. Yeah. So, as David has said, particularly for the disability and carers benefits, we don't know the total size of the eligible population because you have to meet the certain criteria, mm-hmm. and nobody goes out and surveys everybody and checks whether or not they meet the criteria before they apply. But what we do is we look at the number of people flowing on to the benefits, is what we call it, but people successfully applying. So, for example, for the Scottish Carers Assistance, once that launches, we're assuming that in 24-25 there'll be an increase of 2% in inflows, and that'll increase to 5% more people flowing onto the payment in 27-28. And there's a number of reasons for this, and this is partly because we think people will become more aware of the new Social Security payments. We also think Social Security Scotland is committed to being more visible and making the support easier to access. And also because of the changes that the government are proposing to the earnings limit, we also think that might lead to some people changing their working arrangements and therefore claiming the payment. So, and we've made similar assumptions on the disability benefits as well, that we assume there'll be slightly higher inflows, which in a way reflects higher take-up, although we can't give you that as a take-up percentage. And then for the means-tested payments, we have an assumption on take-up for those as well. So, for example, on the Scottish Child Payment, when it launches in the current year, for children over six, we assume 70% of children will take it up. And once it's fully launched, it will be fully launched by the end of this year, but it will take time for people to claim it. And then the next financial year, we assume take-up will be 80%. So that's hopefully gives you an idea of some of the assumptions.
And as the child payment amount has increased, we assume it becomes more meaningful, and that will also affect decisions on take-up.
Thank you. I appreciate that. I have one final question in this area, if that's okay, Convener. And it's around the unemployment rate. And you note in your papers that the unemployment rate is low. Can you tell us something about the types of jobs that people are accessing, and what is the whole picture? Because obviously if people are in low wages or in secure work, then that affects tax take as well. So can you tell us anything deeper on those figures and how that affects the funding envelope available?
David, we don't go down to that level of detail. Okay. When we're forecasting both what's happening for the economy in terms of employment and earnings, and what's happening to primarily income tax revenue, we do that at a pretty aggregate level. We are aware of some of the factors sitting below that. Mm. For example, we have done some analysis of regional disparities in earnings and earnings growth within Scotland compared to other parts of the UK. So we do dig a bit below the surface. But I don't think the work we do gets down to the level of detail that sits behind your question. If employment was to grow, which particular people who might be eligible for benefits mm-hmm. might flow into employment. I think there are other institutes and research bodies that would do that kind of detailed analysis more than we would do.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'll bring Miles Briggs back in to be followed by Paul McLennan, who has a supplementary, who will then take us into our final theme, which is around about the cost of living in the economic context. So, Miles.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener. Yeah, I wanted to follow on some questions there and kind of getting the saying from Donald Rumsfeld of known knowns, unknown unknowns. I think we're probably going round in circles on that. But I wanted to ask in terms of some of the forecasts which previously been around the cost of administering Social Security Scotland, and if you'd looked at that at all in terms of where potential additional costs will be, given the amount of benefits they're going to be administering.
No, I think I may have said something before, and it's always good to remind ourselves and everyone else, we don't look at the cost of administering Social Security in Scotland, and we don't look at any other, you know, perhaps peripheral ramifications of Social Security. So we just look at the payments themselves. That's what we can forecast.
Yeah. No, that's helpful, and I think that's maybe another area of uncertainty.
One point there. One issue that I think we will be facing will be that as Social Security Scotland administers these benefits, it will collect a lot of data. But it may collect that data in a form which is most helpful to it in terms of administering the benefits. That may not be the form that's most helpful to us in terms of doing the forecasts for the future. So there is an area of potential tension there as to how we manage to work with Social Security Scotland to make sure we get the data in the form and of the type that makes it most helpful for us to do our business, given that they're quite rightly their business is primarily focused on delivery.
Yeah, thank you for that. And I wanted to go back to the question with regards to previous examples. Now, obviously, we're in new territory with the levels of Social Security benefits which the Scottish Government will be delivering and how much of the Scottish budget that's going to take up. But I wondered, in terms of previous years around, you touched upon reserves, for example, the reserve. Have underspends also been factored in sometimes to that? And additional money in year being available by the Scottish Government for some of this?
So just a point about how you as a government manage when you are required to have a balanced budget. You pretty much have to plan to underspend in every year so that you don't overspend. There's something about that. So it's a general thing. David, do you
as I said before, one of the things we've been talking about with the Scottish Government is how they plan to manage the reserves, and they're being much more transparent as to how they actually plan to do that. But one issue that needs to be reflected on is that there are very tight limits on what can be paid into the reserves and what can be drawn down on the reserves. And that can make for a challenge to the government, which is different from other governments that might face the same sort of issues of balancing the budget from year to year. So one question which you may want to reflect on is, should those limits change over time in proportion to the scale of the funding that the Scottish Government is undertaking? Is it correct that these limits stay flat in absolute terms?
Just finally, what was that limit at the minute? Did you say 25? I thought £25 million was...
Sorry?
What is the current limit to the Scottish Reserve?
So the Scottish Reserve in total can hold £700 million. And in, I'd say, normal times, the government can draw down £250 million a year to support resource spending. For these couple of years, because there was a quirk with our economic forecast last year, there's been a Scotland-specific economic shock triggered. And that means that reserve limit has been waived for 3 years. So that gives them a little bit more flexibility that they have at the moment, and that flexibility will go again in 2 years' time.
Yeah, that's great. Thank you. Thanks, Camina.
Thanks very much. Paul, over to you, and then you'll be followed by Faisal Chowdhury, who is online.
Thank you, Camina. Claire, I want to pick up on a point that you made around about and the consequentials of and decisions that are made by Westminster and how that can impact on your forecasting. And I suppose it then looks at the wider picture of within the existing fiscal framework that's in place just now. And it's really commenting on, does the fiscal framework assist you in your forecasting and obviously assist the Scottish Government? Because obviously then it impacts on the level of spend that we can look at in terms of social justice. So the fiscal framework, for me, it needs changed. But I'm just wondering, in terms of where you come from, in terms of the art of forecasting, does it help or does it hinder you? And is there more being done in that? Because I think there's obvious amendments required to it. But I just wonder, in terms of what your job in forecasting, does it help or hinder?
So I will give you a general response, and you'll realise I'm not going to answer that specifically, because the fiscal framework is an agreement between the Scottish Government and the UK Government. There is a plan to revisit that over this year, and that will happen at some point. I don't know when results will come from that. So that review will happen, and that was baked in when taxes were first devolved, that the point of having that review at this stage, and that was to learn from how it's worked. So the question is a really good one, but we're not in a position to say how it should change. That really is up to the government.
I suppose it's not so much in where you think the specific changes are. I suppose maybe then, and I can appreciate where you're coming from in terms of that. But in terms of your forecasting work, does it help or hinder that? Because I'm sure at some stage you'd have some input into what you think that would look like. And I'm not asking you, I can understand why you're not in that. But does it help or hinder you in terms of your forecast? And I think that's a key thing.
I don't think we could forecast properly if we didn't have a framework. Yeah. So, you know, the fact that we have a framework it helps in that sense. It's a complicated arrangement. Yeah. Between Scotland and the UK, Claire.
So and I'm not trying to put words in my mouth, does it need simplified in if that's the case?
I have a personal view about simplification, so I'll turn to Claire.
Don't answer if you don't want to.
I'll get myself into trouble here.
I might give a politician's answer and answer your previous question. So I think it's worth thinking about, there's our role forecasting in terms of we're forecasting components of the Scottish budget, and you can think about that very narrowly in terms of we're forecasting how much directly the Scottish government spends on social security, we're forecasting how much it collects in tax revenue. But those forecasts are essentially on some level meaningless if you don't take into account the wider budget, if you don't take into account the funding arrangements from the UK government. So we include that commentary in our report to try and help yourselves and media and public understand what that means for the Scottish budget. It's not an easy task because the fiscal framework is complicated. I think everybody admits that. In terms of whether or how it should be changed, that is for other people to decide. But I do think it's worth pointing out, our December report, it was a previous report, I'm pretty sure it was December, we did comment on how particularly things like late consequentials from the UK government, so the UK government does what they call supplementary estimates, which are normally in February, and that can actually change how much money the Scottish government is getting quite late in the financial year. Particularly during COVID, some of the changes here were really significant. And those limits sometimes are much greater than the reserve. But what we have seen on several occasions is that Treasury has reached an agreement with the Scottish Government that allows them to defer those consequentials. So the fiscal framework sets the rules, but there's also times when you can see the two governments reaching an agreement which recognises that those rules, if put in place in a very strict sense, would create difficulties for the Scottish Government.
Just to remind you that there are two elements of the work we do.
Yeah.
One is forecasting, but the other one, as I said before, is commenting on the reasonableness of the government's borrowing plans. So I wouldn't say the fiscal framework makes forecasting any harder or easier. What the fiscal framework does is, whatever it is, we have to make those comments on the reasonableness of the government's plans for how it manages reserves and how it plans to borrow. So that's what the area where the structure of the fiscal framework will change the way in which we actually think about those issues, but also how the Scottish Government thinks about those issues.
That's helpful. Listen, thank you. Thank you.
Thanks very much. If we can go to Faisal Chowdhury, who joins us online, to be followed by Emma Roddick. Faisal.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. I've got two questions. How can they be sure that inflation is just a spike and not an upward trajectory? If the obvious less positive projections about what happens next year come true, how will that affect our future spending commitments?
The simple answer is we can't be certain about inflation being just a spike or not. We just don't know. But we have thought about that within our forecasts, and we took the judgment to keep the view about inflation peaking at the end of this calendar year or the end of this year as central to our forecast. But what we did was we lay out a downside risk to the forecast, which is that inflation becomes entrenched, that it lasts over a longer period of time. And that risk seems a little greater because of factors. But there's so much that could happen that will affect inflation. And it's not just inflation, it's the impact of inflation. So earlier I pointed out that the Chancellor's recent package will be helping lower income households this year to ease the impact of inflation, but that's only one off, and that's just for this year. So your question is important, how long will it last, but it's pretty hard for us to say.
And the second question, So the second question.
I'm going to ask the second question. I mean, why does Scotland's earning growth lag behind the rest of the UK?
Oh, gosh. Can I suggest something? You were just going to come in on the back of the last question and then we'll go to this. Yeah, why don't you do that?
It was just to answer the question on OBR forecast. And if you're referring to how the Scottish Government's budget is set in terms of block grant funding, the UK Government had a spending review, so the first 2 years are based on UK Government's commitments and spending plans. After that, we're using OBR forecasts of UK Government spending levels. So that for the next 2 years in particular, how the block grant differs from what the Government have included in their resource spending review will depend on UK Government spending decisions rather than OBR forecast changes.
Thank you very much, Claire. And then for your next question, there are several factors. A couple we've been talking about for quite a while. We have a different demography in Scotland. We have a greater population, and it's growing, of people who are aging out of the full-time work space. And we don't have a large population of youngsters who will be growing into that workspace. So if you have fewer people working, that affects ultimately what both productivity and tax and so forth. But there's another specific factor that is reflected in our current forecasts. The oil and gas sector has been depressed recently, and so if you're looking at impacts on funding, the jobs that pay well have an impact if there are fewer of those jobs and people aren't in them in terms of tax. But also counterbalancing that sector, you have a real boom, if you will, in the financial sector, in London-based parts of the financial services sector, where particularly bonuses, but income has been very high. So you've got a bifurcation there as well. So that's part of what we're reflecting. David, you want to give some more texture, possibly?
Well, just one other point to make is that, going back to some of these demographic issues to which Susan referred, one thing we've identified in our data is that the youth participation rate in Scotland is lower than the rest of the UK, and recently seems to be in falling. We don't have a full understanding yet of why that is the case, and that's an area we want to go into in greater detail in the future. Obviously, one factor that could be at work here is simply that young people are choosing to go more into higher education or tertiary education because they see the job situation in the future being more challenging. If they want to get ahead, they need to get more skills and education to do that. So they may be delaying getting into the labour market for that reason. But it's an area we want to do more work and thinking about for the future.
Thank you very much. I think that was a very helpful scene setting that you just did in terms of that situation. I'll hand over to Emma Roderick for her question, and then Pam Duncan-Glancy with a final one. We are kind of slightly running a wee bit over time, and we do have another panel to come in, but I feel it's important that we hear these questions. Emma.
Thank you, Convener. I just wanted to ask, I found it helpful that you identified that lower income households are going to face higher inflation relative to high earners because of the cost of essential items. Is inflation on essential items expected to stabilise as quickly as the CPI overall estimate of 2% by 2024, or is it going to be, you know, quicker, slower?
Again, if you had a crystal ball, you might be able to tell us that. I mean, the really big hits are around the cost of energy. It's people, you know, needing to heat themselves. They need to get petrol put in their car, all of that. And it's cost of food as well. And there are various factors that are having an impact. We are a net importer of energy. And any country which is will be subject to rising prices that are more in a global scale. So we it's not in our gift in the whole of the UK to change that very quickly, although there certainly is a big push towards renewables and things that we can own here, but that's a long game. That isn't going to happen just now. Or it is happening, but it will take a long time to kick in properly. So it's hard to say, but you know, the COVID, the extreme response in China to COVID has made a real difference. The biggest port in the world is Shanghai. So you look at what's manufactured in China and then what gets sent out. You stop that even for a period of two and a half months. That makes a difference. So that's now opening up. But it's very hard to say where this will all go. The conflict in Ukraine is certainly not helping in these areas.
But maybe one thing to add is that what's been driving the inflation we've seen, although, as I said before, it looks like cost-push inflation, so that's partly driven by the fact that as lots of countries have come out of the pandemic, demand has suddenly soared for energy and other raw material inputs. So you've got that sort of supply shock hitting a demand shock, and that's what's been driving this up. As economies adjust to that, some of those elements will disappear, and we don't see at the moment what the next supply shock would be that would come through and drive prices up at the scale we've seen over the last year or so. So we still think it's reasonable, as a central assumption, to assume that inflation will fall for those items, but there's a huge uncertainty.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. And over to yourself, Pam.
Thank you. Thank you very much. It was a follow-up, actually, if that's OK, briefly on the point about youth participation. I guess it goes back to probably my less helpful wording on my question earlier on. What other understandings do you have of inequalities in workforce participation, such as you've described for low-level youth participation?
Well, as I said before, we don't, on the whole, delve down in too much into distributional issues. A lot of our forecasts are based around aggregates or average levels. Obviously, we are aware of the fact that sitting behind that there are distributional factors. So when we're forecasting growth in earnings, it's an average growth in average earnings, but we are aware that that might differ across the distribution. It's quite hard to say exactly how it differs across the distribution. Going back to the point that Emma made, well, there are big differential impacts of inflation across the distribution, and again, we're sensitive to that. But we don't, on the whole, drill down to that level of detail to really understand what's happening at every level of the distribution in terms of growth of earnings, growth of employment, participation. Levels there. There are other research institutes that do that work, but it's not part of our work.
Thank you. I appreciate that. And I know that you gave a similar answer earlier, and it was just when you'd mentioned the youth employment. I thought, maybe I've worded it badly first time round, and there is more. But I take that point. Thank you for that. My final question was around the cost of living, and in particular in the Scottish Government's Child Poverty Delivery Plan, and whether or not you felt that the current review and also in your forecasting takes account of the money that's going to be required to deliver that plan, and can you see aspects in the Government's plans that show there is going to be money attached to each of the outcomes within that delivery plan?
Again, we're not making judgments about the costs of administering, but Claire, is there anything we can say?
We have taken account of the policies the government has included in the Child Poverty Delivery Plan, which affect social security spending. So we included the increase in the Scottish Child Payment to £25 a week. There's also the removal of Best Start Foods income thresholds. And also we have assumed that benefit cap mitigation starts fairly swiftly. So we assume there's £4 million of spending on benefit cap mitigation in this financial year, rising to £11 million next financial year. So those are the factors that we have included from the child poverty.
And the other factors, including around employability support, are there any plans for you guys to look at those factors as well, particularly given the constraints that colleagues have highlighted in other areas in the budget?
Yes. So the part of employability which we do take account of is currently the Scottish Government has the Fair Start Scotland programme. they haven't fully committed to what's going to happen afterwards, but similarly to how we took account of the Scottish carers assistance, the replacement for attendance allowance, these other payments, we have included in our forecast provision for a replacement employability service, which is from 25 million pounds a year onwards. So that's included in the resource spending review.
And finally, just one question to kind of push a little bit further on that. Do you see a direct correlation between the outcomes and the child poverty delivery plan and the spending review? Can you see where the money has been allocated and whether or not it's likely to be enough?
So we're not looking beyond social security. We're not looking at individual government spending lines.
Okay.
We only included the portfolio level analysis, which wouldn't go into that level of detail. But there will be other people out there who are looking at this in detail.
Thank you.
And that was a very good answer at the end there, Claire, because it's incumbent upon us to find those other people to get them to come to help us scrutinise those plans. So thank you very much to all three of you for coming along this morning and giving your evidence. And I will suspend briefly for a changeover of panels. Thank you very much. Good morning and welcome back to our meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. We're now on to agenda item number 3. The committee is going to take evidence on the Disability Assistance for Working Age People Transitional Provisions and Miscellaneous Amendments, Scotland Regulations 2022. And I welcome to the meeting in person Ben McPherson, Minister for Social Security and Local Government, Kate Thompson-McDermott, who is the Head of Carers Benefit and Case Transfer Policy Unit at the Scottish Government. And joining us remotely, we have Kayleigh Blair, who is a solicitor for the Scottish Government, and Darren Kelly, Head of Operations Dundee at Social Security Scotland. And I'll invite the Minister to make an opening statement.
Good morning, Convener and colleagues. Thank you for inviting me to give evidence today on the Disability Assistance for Working Age People Transitional Provisions and Miscellaneous Amendment Regulations 2022. Let me begin by saying I'm grateful for our recent discussion on case transfer more generally, which I hope you found useful as well. I also appreciate the work of the committee to date in considering the case transfer provisions for people whose awards are moving from disability living allowance to child disability payment and from personal independence payment to adult disability payment. The draft regulations we are discussing today mirror the processes in those regulations in many ways, but there are some key differences which I will come to shortly. As I've set out to the committee and Parliament before, we are determined to ensure that case transfer is a seamless process and that we transfer people's awards safely and securely. This is not a simple administrative process. We are transferring and then refining information from DW systems, some of which are decades old, to Social Security Scotland's new agile single benefit system. Making sure we have the right information and that no one falls out of payment across approximately 700,000 awards that will transfer is a project that takes planning and time. We are doing this work at pace, whilst ensuring we do not risk the undertaking of the process in a safe and secure way. Protecting payments is, of course, our absolute focus. The benefits in question are payments of money that people rely on, and we will make sure that recipients continue to get paid the right amount at the time they expect. From the 13th of June, we will pilot the personal independence payment transfer, with full transfer beginning at the end of August with the national introduction of our adult disability payment. At this point, adults who receive disability living allowance, or DLA, and would otherwise be required to apply for personal independence payment will start to see their awards selected for transfer. It is this transfer that we are here to discuss today, known as natural case transfer. The draft regulations before the committee will ensure that a Scottish resident born after the 8th of April 1948 will have their disability living allowance award selected for transfer to adult disability payment if one of the following three criteria are met. One, a change of circumstance relevant to the DLA award is reported, or two, where the DLA award is due to be renewed, or three, where the person asks to have their DLA award transferred. Once the transfer completes, the person's initial adult disability payment award will be a like-for-like copy of their DLA award. Then, because the eligibility rules for DLA and adult disability payment are different, the person's award will be reviewed and adult disability payment rules will apply. I must be clear that this review will mean that some people's awards will stay the same, while some people may see their awards ended, reduced, or increased. That said, this process will not be a repeat of the DWP's transition from DLA to personal independence payment. In line with our case transfer principles, people will not have to apply for adult disability payment like they had to apply for personal independence payment. Instead, they will be supported through a review process. People undergoing this review will have our new forms of support available to them through our local delivery service and our independent advocacy service. People will have the enhanced rights we have built into adult disability payment available at every stage of the process, and I will briefly outline that support now. We have replaced the the adversarial approach of the DWP through the removal of assessments and degrading examinations, and we start from a position of trust in what people tell us. The onus will be on Social Security Scotland to collect information on people's behalf, and they will only need to collect one piece of formal supporting information when making a decision. Short-term assistance will be available for anyone that has a reduced or nil award after the review and wishes to seek a redetermination or appeal. And finally, we are also exploring ways of providing support to anyone who may lose the enhanced mobility component on review, given the impact this will have on their ability to continue to access the AVE scheme. And I will update committee as soon as I can on this. In conclusion, convener, we have designed this process to be as supportive as possible, while acknowledging the challenges that moving between different benefits and different rules could create. I believe we have struck the right balance with these regulations, and I'm now happy to take any questions.
Thank you very much, Minister, for your opening statement. I will now move on to questions from members, and to kick us off, Deputy Convener Natalie Dawn will come in to be followed by Faisal Chowdhury, who joins us remotely. Natalie.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister, and good morning to the rest of the panel. Can the Minister expand on the plans for the tailored communication and the support for those transferring from DLA to ADP?
Certainly. Well, we have developed a strategic communication and engagement plan for case transfer, as you would expect. This covers how we plan to communicate key messages and timings, and our plans for stakeholder engagement, which of course are very important, and also paid for marketing communications activity. Additionally, we are developing a wide range of clear communications to help support people transferring from disability living allowance to adult disability payment. And these include easy-to-read notifications so clients know what is happening at every part of the transfer journey, a specific leaflet consistent with SCOSI's recommendations to explain the differences between disability living allowance and adult disability payment. And it will also encourage people to get independent advice before making a decision to ask to have their award transferred. We will also be undertaking a series of stakeholder roadshows, which will begin this month, outlining the transfer process for this group to our key stakeholders. And we also have a stakeholder toolkit, which will include specific fact sheets, video content, and frequently asked questions to stakeholders. We are developing specific case transfer guidance to provide stakeholders with further information on the case transfer process, and this guidance will be hosted on socialsecurity.gov.scot, the website. And we know that in this client group that we're talking about today with regard to these regulations can be particularly difficult to reach. So we will be relying on our public and third sector partners to help get the word out. And of course, as the government undertakes this work, of course, we'd encourage MSP colleagues to, as I do across what we do in Social Security, to continue to raise awareness in your constituencies and regions. Thank you.
Thank you. Touched on my next question there, which was going to be how will people be helped to decide whether they would be better off volunteering to move to ADP? And I know that you mentioned independent advice about award transfer. So it's just, will that advice be given by Social Security Scotland, or will people be asked to or signposted to another advice service?
So in addition to the significant communications we are developing that I've just gone over, advocacy and local delivery services will be available too. So the advocacy service, as colleagues know, is a free service available to anyone who identifies as disabled and requires support to engage with Social Security Scotland. So that will be there and available. Everyone's circumstances are different, so we encourage everyone who is thinking about asking to have their benefit transferred to seek independent advice in their situation and circumstances. Also, in the current financial year, the Scottish Government is investing approximately £12 million in funding to support the provision of free welfare and debt advice, as the committee is aware, as well as our independent advocacy service. And this funding will help people access the advice and support that they need in a way that, that works for them, whether that's face-to-face, online or over the phone. And as I've mentioned, we have our local delivery teams in every authority area from Social Security Scotland as well. So we would encourage people to seek the advice and information they need.
Okay, thank you, Minister. I have no further questions just now.
Thank you. Next question will be from Faisal Chowdhury, who's online, to be followed by Jeremy Balfour. Faisal, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. I think you've answered quite a few of the questions I was going to ask, but I just want to add that our Social Security Scotland and DWP working together to ensure that clients get consistent communication from both agencies.
Thanks for that question, Mr. Chair. I think it's an important one, given that we are still in a joint delivery programme with the DWP. It's a joint case transfer, is a joint project between ourselves and the DWP, and we work closely together to develop our processes and guidance to make sure that people get consistent answers to their questions. Individual client communications developed by each organisation are shared so that we can ensure that we are giving the same messages. As an example of our joined up approach, when an award is selected for transfer, the DWP will write to the client to let them know that their disability living allowance has been selected for transfer and will be coming to an end. And then we will write out to introduce the person to Social Security Scotland and will provide information about the transfer process. So that's an example of of how both organisations will work together to make sure that people are informed and properly appraised of the process that they will be going through.
Thank you.
Thanks very much for that. We will now go to Jeremy Balfour, who will be followed by Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister, and to your team. Two questions. If I could follow up a bit just on the Deputy Convener's second question there previously. I'm just trying to get into my head this understanding of what advice people will be given, whether they should transfer or not, because clearly the ultimate decision will be made by Social Security Scotland when we review all the papers. I mean, you appreciate from your legal days that what weight does the advice, if I phone up and say, should I transfer across, and an advisor takes me through that, that's the advisor's decision, isn't it? It's not the decision of Social Security Scotland. And how will that be very clear to the individual that this is not definitely going to happen, but it's only the person's opinion?
So, first of all, just reiterate what I've said about how we would encourage people to get independent advice. And to utilise the resources that are being made available by the Scottish Government for that independent advice. What the agency can do is advise on individual entitlement in terms of describing to people in their circumstances, because as I've emphasised, everyone's circumstances are different, what the situation will be for them. We would strongly advise people to take that independent advice from the Advocacy Service and Welfare Provision that we're providing that outlined in my answer to the Deputy Convener.
And that will be made clear when we phone up the agency to get that initial comment that the best thing to do would be to seek advice from an independent individual.
Yeah, because I should have been clear that the agency can't advise on entitlement, because obviously people have got to go through the process.
Yeah.
Just to be absolutely clear and correct my previous answer, the agency can't advise on entitlement because people will have to go through that process. But through our work with stakeholders, and I'll bring Kate Thompson-McDermott in a minute with anything further that she wants to add, but through our engagement with stakeholders, we're of course doing what we can to make sure that those that people would turn to for that advice, as well as our independent advice service throughout Scotland, are well appraised of this process so that they can help people in that decision making in their individual circumstances. Okay, I don't know if you want to add anything further.
Just just to kind of build on what the Minister said about the technicalities of the process. Once somebody has contacted the Department for Work and Pensions and asked to have their case transferred, then it will be transferred. It will be put in the case transfer pot, and that process will be gone through. So it's very important to us that we are trying to get the communications and messages and signposting for support out there and to people before they make that decision and make that phone call, and that's very important. So we are designing our communications plan and the supporting materials to make sure we can try and reach people ahead of making that decision, because once the decision has been made to transfer, then the cases will transfer. There's no ability to put a brake on or reverse that process at any stage.
Thank you. I think that's helpful for that clarification. The second issue, just for a point that you made towards the end of your opening statement, I welcome the review in regard to looking at the mobility issue, and particularly in regard to the car. And you said that review is taking place. Clearly, the pilot programme starts, and then the full programme runs out in August, or starts in August fully. When do you expect that review to complete? And have you any feeling of where that might go? That's an unfair second question, but more point, when do you think the review will be complete?
So we had hoped to be able to tell committee about this today. We are working closely with Motability to ensure that those on that move onto accessible vehicle scheme have access to the transitional protection scheme provided for individuals that lose their enhanced mobility award when transferring from DLA. There are different rules depending on when the individual joined the Motability scheme, as Mr Balfour will be aware. But in most cases, this will allow the client to keep the vehicle for 8 weeks after the end of entitlement and receive a £2,000 payment. We have neared formal agreement to this approach with Motability, and we just need to continue our discussions with them. But I would be happy to write to the committee when this is confirmed, and we are seeking to do that as soon as possible. I don't know if you want to add anything to that from this.
That would be very helpful. Thank you, Minister. Thank you, Convener.
Thanks very much. I'll now bring in Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Convener. Hello, Minister. I realise the hope is that people will understand that they might be better off on ADP than they are on DLA and opt to transfer when they can. What challenges will be presented around managed migration if a lot of cases end up not transferring through the natural migration process, and what negative effects might there be for those claimants if they don't move?
We still have so as I referred to in my opening statement, we call this part of the process where I talked about the three circumstances in which people would be part of the cohort transferring in these regulations, and that we call this natural case transfer. We still have managed case transfer to undertake for working age disability living allowance into ADP, and have considerations to undertake on that. The position is clear that if these circumstances are the three different situations are realised for clients, then they will be selected as part of this process. And of course, we've worked to make sure that people do not undergo a DWP style assessment and are asked to apply for PIP. So a lot of the motivation behind this natural case transfer process is to seek to prevent people having to go through that process of a PIP assessment and instead be transferred onto adult disability payment, and then there'll be a review of their situation in due course.
Thank you very much. I'll move on to some further questions around about transitional protections that my colleague Pam Duncan-Glancy would like to come in on. Pam.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister, and to the others who have joined us from the panel. I'd just like to upfront to say that there are aspects of these regs, as in other areas on ADP, that of course we welcome. For example, the terminal illness rules and the different approach. So my questions are kind of on the basis that we will support these regs today. but I just have a few questions about some of the decisions that have been taken till now. So obviously the amount of the move from DLA to ADP is not necessarily because someone's circumstances have changed. It's an administrative change. How can you guarantee, and can you guarantee, the no worse off principle as part of the Social Security Commission? How can you guarantee that for the people who are going to be moving from DLA to ADP, particularly in the midst of a cost of living crisis?
So, as I talked about in my opening statement, we've thought about how this process will affect individuals. So there's the case transfer process that will be undertaken, and then the question of the review thereafter, which I think is what you're referring to, if I'm not mistaken, Pam Duncan Glancy. So as case transfer takes place, it's important to acknowledge that no one would be worse off than they would be if they stayed with the DWP. So that's a very, very clear position. In a situation where their case is then reviewed, which of course will happen in due course, where there will be differentiation in our system is that if an award is increased after being reviewed, then that increase will be backdated to the point of case transfer, ensuring that no one misses out. So people who receive an increase will receive that backdating, which doesn't happen in the current system. If an award is decreased, the change will only take effect from the date the decision is made. So there would be no overpayment that the person would be asked to repay. So that is a clear difference that will be of advantage to people.
Thank you for that. And that both of those circumstances I know will be welcome. And just in case I forget to do this, and I have in the past, so please allow me to do it just now, to declare an interest and refer members to my register of interest as someone who receives PIP, and at some point assumes I will transfer to ADP. Those aspects that you've just set out, Minister, are both really, really helpful. I'm still not clear, though, if you think that some people will be worse off. Can you specifically commit to the no worse off principle for this?
So during case transfer, no one will be worse off.
But in the long term.
But after review, I cannot speak for individual circumstances. That will be part of the review process under the eligibility rules for adult disability payment. But we, you know, we explored a number of options, of course, for persuading people who may see a reduction in award or a nil award when their adult disability payment is reviewed. And I'll just set out some of those now that are different. So we will support people in a number of ways. First of all, we are ensuring individuals transfer on their current award levels, as I've stated, in the first instance, so that they can be supported through the review process. And we are setting out clearly in advance the support available to them through our local delivery service and independent advocacy service, as I answered in response to the Deputy Convener. And then individuals will benefit from the changes we've made to adult disability payment to ensure that they are treated with dignity, fairness and respect, including that we will trust what they tell us. We will place the onus on Social Security Scotland to collect information on people's behalf during the review and only require one piece of formal supporting information. And importantly, people will have the right to challenge any decision that sees a reduction in their award or a nil award, and they will have access to short-term assistance through that process. So there will be significant improvements in the situation for people than if they'd been in the DWP system.
Thank you, and I don't doubt that at all. I mean, the current DWP system, particularly from moving to DLA and to PIP, is well documented on how poor it is. And so it is welcome hugely that the Scottish Government will take a different approach to that, including to protect people for that bit longer. But ultimately, at the end of that period of time, you said earlier people will not have to reapply like they do now from DLA to PIP, but ultimately they will. It will just be longer, and then they'll have to make an application for ADP,
So they won't have to make an application. Their case will be reviewed, and it will be a light touch review process in the way that we've set out that review processes for ADP will be undertaken.
Okay, that's helpful. Thank you, that is helpful. Had you at any point considered, and I'm sure there'll be...
It depends on the individual circumstances of the individual, of course, as well. I can't speak generically. Sorry to interrupt you.
No, that's okay. It's important that we can have dialogue on this. There'll be... Disabled people will be watching and worrying, I guess, as anyone on DLA transferring to either PIP or ADP worries. You know, it's not a great feeling when the review happens, as I'm sure we'll all appreciate and everyone understands that. So it's really clear that the communication that you're putting out is important and that the messages are important. At any point, given that in the previous years, the particularly your government and our party have said that the changes from DLA to PIP were a concern, and at any point did you consider replicating some of the systems in DLA in ADP so that you could have created a like-for-like benefit for those people as well, given that you had so many problems with when the UK government changed to PIP?
We have, of course, thought about a lot of different options here, and I'll bring Kate Thompson-McDermott in a moment, because a considerable amount of work done, and of course the big challenge for us is that we obtained these powers over disability benefits when the UK system was still in a position of transition between DLA and personal independence payment, but we have tried to make decisions sensitively and effectively to improve our system, but also undertake case transfer in a safe and secure way. And I don't know if you want to add anything.
Yes, just to say we looked at a whole manner of options. Obviously, when we first started looking at case transfer, the expectation had been that the managed migration from DLA to PIP would have completed before we took Parliament and ministers took competency for disability benefits. So when it was clear that wasn't going to happen, then obviously the first kind of action was to ask that managed migration process was halted. And we then looked at a number of options. We've looked at whether we could transfer cases administratively into the SPM system but keep them within the DLA legislative framework. That poses quite significant challenges because we would essentially have to build DLA into Social Security Scotland systems and train up staff to work to DLA and to work to the kind of DWP legislative framework, so to carry out revisions and supersessions rather than redeterminations and appeals. So the whole framework that comes with the benefit would essentially have needed to be recreated within SPM, which would have been a huge undertaking, which would have impacted our ability to deliver ADP and going further. We then looked at, well, can we do a hybrid system? Can we bring... can we create a benefit within the 2018 framework that has the eligibility and criteria components for DLA but is otherwise within that 2018 framework, so we can use the same rules in SPM for appeals and redeterminations and reviews, and you know, so that's within the Scottish system, which would also be better for clients. Mm-hmm. And we did look at that, and it was just not possible to deliver that in time for ADP national. And we really looked at it every which way. That's still very much an option we're considering for DLA managed and for DLA 65+. And we hope to be able to kind of come back to the committee with our kind of decisions on that in due course. So that is still an option that's being considered, but it was not one that was going to be able to be delivered by ADP National. And we wanted to ensure we had an option in place from ADP National that clients could move on to ADP and go through the ADP process rather than have to move on to PIP. And this was the best option that could be delivered.
Thank you, and that's really clear. I guess I'm trying to get at the question of when designing ADP, did you at any point, Minister, consider replicating the kind of best of both from PIP and DLA so that the system for ADP transfer was a much, much smoother, I guess, for anyone who was coming from DLA or PIP, because the system was able to look at the eligibility criteria across both of those things?
I mean, I would just refer to what's just been said, but also that we, of course, have to transfer people on personal independence payment into PIP and need a consistency of the rules that's like for like with personal independence payment. And you know, we have 300,000 personal independence payment case transfers. So,
I see that. So versus 40,000 from the deal, I see the figures. I was just keen to know if there was thinking, and perhaps then just following from that, some of the recommendations in SCOS kind of hinge on the review process. And I guess that's also back to the point around some of the eligibility. Can you give us an update on that review process at this point?
Certainly. So it's important that we prioritise case transfer now of any individual that would otherwise be required to apply for personal independence payment under the DWP business as usual rules. So I know colleagues are appreciative of that. So we have already made significant improvements to the assessment process for adult disability payment, and we'll apply the eligibility criteria fairly and consistently to all those entitled to adult disability payment, and to ensure that the impact of a disability or health condition on an individual, including the impact on mental health conditions, learning disabilities and fluctuating conditions, are taken fully into account. As Pam Duncan Glancy has rightly emphasised, we have given a firm commitment to a wide-ranging independent review of adult disability payment commencing 1 year after the national launch of adult disability payment, and in active discussions in recent days on that with officials. However, given the extensive feedback received, we, as you know, further committed to a two-stage review, with work beginning later this year to identify what improvements could be made on the mobility criteria and what scope of the Stage 2 independent review should include. We will provide details on both of these as soon as we are in a position to do so. And I appreciate that with regard to the first stage, both members and stakeholders and more broadly, people are interested to get an update on that, and certainly give an undertaking to do that as soon as we can.
Okay, thank you. My final question in this area is on the support, and you have touched on this already about the support people will get through the transitional arrangements. Do you have an understanding of how many people you think will need that kind of independent support through the advocacy service or indeed other third sector organisations, and have you looked at the capacity that would be required in those organisations to meet that?
As I laid out in my answer to the deputy convener and around those first questions, so you'll know that our resourcing for the independent advocacy service is set out and budgeted for and being provided and scaled up. I talked about the £12 million that we've provisioned for welfare advice and the government provides. And I talked about the engagement with stakeholders that is being undertaken with officials. And you know, we have a very close both agency and government relationship with relevant stakeholders. And the fact that we have an understanding that the quantity of transfers per month will be around 100 means that we have capacity in the systems in Scotland and within the agency, of course, and within the advocacy service to be able to provide that support to around 100 people a month.
Thank you. I have no further questions on this.
Thank you very much. We have some questions around about the issue of backdating. I'll bring Emma Roddick in on that, to be followed by Jeremy Balfour and then Miles Briggs. Emma.
Sorry, convener, can I just have a moment?
Yeah, absolutely. I'll go to Jeremy first, if that's okay. Oh, then I'll come back to you.
Yeah, my computer's just gone quiet, so I'll let Miles go first.
Miles!
Working, luckily, in that case. Good morning, Minister. Good morning to the panel as well. I wanted to actually sort of follow on from Pam Duncan Glancy's line of questioning, because I just wondered what work the Scottish Government had also been undertaking to, you know, really predict the number of people who may see their award ended or reduced, and whether that modelling has been undertaken.
Well, it depends on the individual circumstances. I mean, it's very hard to We have to evaluate every case on the merits of the individual's position, and the fact that we'll of course be doing every review from a position of trust, but the situation with Pitt, we have some awareness of what has happened with Pitt, but of course our system has differences built into it. I mean, I think you were just hearing about some of the implications of that from the Fiscal Commission this morning. We know that from DLA to PIP, there is about a third that have received an increase, a third have received a decrease, and a third have stayed the same. But as I said, we will treat every case individually, as people would expect, and we will, of course, project where we can, but we want to make sure that people are assessed individually and within their circumstances and don't prejudice that.
So I take from your answer there that that's where you think this may go, a third, a third, a third.
I'm not saying that, because that's the evidence from PIP to Disability Living Allowance to PIP, but that is the basis of evidence from the DWP's undertaking of their process, that we have some evidence for, we will see how that situation develops in our system, and of course a key point of emphasis that members will be appreciative of is that we expect to get more decisions right first time. And the third, a third, a third that I talked about, of course, are initial findings, but then 65% of PIP appeals are successful. So there's a different outcome in the end when it comes to the situation with DLA to PIP. We have those background situations on which to consider how this process into adult disability payment will progress. Certainly we would look to get decisions right first time. I know that's a determination of ours, so we're likely to see more successful.
Okay. I don't know if anyone else wants to come on in on that. I don't know if Mr. Kelly would have an opinion on that modelling.
Asking, sorry.
Is it not for me to bring in my officials if I wish to?
It is for you to bring them in if you wish to bring them in, Minister.
Thank you, Convener. With apologies, Mr. Bray. Mr. Kelly, if there's anything you want to add from an agency perspective, then feel free to do so. But I think of course, members will be aware that our determination is to get more decisions right first time, and to the process that I've set out of how people will move, have moved from DLA to PIP is background information, but we are at the beginning of the process when it comes to Social Security Scotland.
Sorry, the only thing I would add is just the investment and time we've put into training and working closely with our DWP colleagues to ensure that we do get that decision right first time. But I don't have anything else to add on that.
Thank you very much, Mr. Kelly. Do you have anything further at this point? I'll go back to Emma Roddick, if we can, and then after that, Jeremy Balfour. Emma, please.
Thank you, Convener. I'm aware that SCOS were concerned about the backdating to the start of the ADP claim rather than when a change of circumstance is reported. As the natural case transfer by definition applies to those who are coming forward with a change of circumstances, what difference is there likely to be between those two dates?
So when it comes to increases that result in a change of person's conditions, we do not estimate there will be any increased costs because our approach largely mirrors disability living allowance to personal independence payment transition, which is covered in the funding we receive from the block grant adjustment. However, our approach to any decreases will likely increase our costs as we are choosing to be more generous than the DWP policy. So the position with increases, as I've said, will be backdated to when the case transfer happened. With regard to decreases, we will only apply that from the date of the review rather than a change of circumstances or case transfer. So it will be the when the person's review outcome is decided, and if, of course, if they choose to undertake a redetermination or appeal, then they'll get short-term assistance through that process. So it would only be from the conclusion of their review that the any decrease or nil award would be applied.
Thank you very much. Now over to yourself, Jeremy.
Thank you. I think just probably for clarification, so the Minister is going to follow, I don't think anyone for Social Security Scotland works for him. That's hopefully an independent body away from Scottish Government. But maybe just so that there's no misunderstanding on that. Just a very quick question, Minister. There does seem to be a difference in the treatment and the extent of backdating available to people transferring from DLA compared to those transferring from PIP. Did you look at any mitigating measures around that?
Can you just refine that question, Mr. Balfour, just so I'm so clear what you're asking?
My understanding in regard to the backdating available, but it is different for DLA compared to that with PIP.
Yeah.
And there may be people who will be less well off with that mitigation happening, especially with that transfer happening. And I'm just wondering whether there had been any mitigation looked at that.
So I've talked about when there's an increase that will be from the date of case transfer. In terms of a reduction or a nil award, there is the process of case transfer, so that'll be 13 to 17 weeks. And then if there's any appeal or review, so that'll take a period. And then any
redetermination
or appeal. There may be circumstances where under the DWP system that time would have been longer but before the reduction was applied. But in a significant amount of circumstances, and I'll bring Kate Thompson-McDermott in a moment, and we anticipate that in the event of a decrease or a nil award, people will, because of short-term assistance and because of the fact that we will only apply the decrease from the date of final decision rather than date of transfer or change of circumstance, which is the situation with the DWP, that people will generally be better off within our system. Do you want to add anything to that?
I mean, and yes, just to kind of add a wee bit more. So our approach across all the case transfers seeks to ensure that people are not financially disadvantaged as a result of the transfer. Obviously, prior to transfer, there are different rules for different groups of people, and people are in different circumstances, and what we do is try and look at what would have happened if they stayed at DWP, and ensuring that when we move them over that they're in an, if not an analogous position, then they will be better off. So for each of the case transfers there will be slightly different rules in terms of kind of effective dates and processes and backdating to make sure that we're matching as closely as possible the journey that clients would have continued on had they stayed with DWP.
So to follow that up, then people may be less well off long term for that period under DLA compared to PIP, or is it the other way around? Which of the two is likely to see somebody getting that backdating happening quicker than the other one, or are they both the same?
They match the journey. So if somebody had been moving from DLA to PIP, then they obviously would have to put a PIP application in, average of 22 to 26 weeks of processing for that application, and then any increase or decrease would have been applied for that point. So when we move somebody from DLA onto ADP, obviously have to wait, as the Minister has explained, and then we backdate the increase, but we wouldn't seek to backdate the decrease. So they will get the increase around about the same time, in some circumstances a bit quicker. The decrease will come through much later. For PIP, then what we try and do is match what the effective date would have been had that change of, for the natural case transfers, had that change of condition been considered by DWP and the review undertaken by DWP and PIP, and then we will try and best we can kind of match the effective date rules for when they move over. So I think it depends on the individual circumstances of the cases for most of the time.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. We'll move on to our last theme, which is around about monitoring and evaluation. And I'll bring in Deputy Convener Natalie Dawn for a question on that. Natalie.
Thanks, Convener. So in relation to the case transfer communication strategy that we discussed earlier, can the Minister advise how this will be evaluated over time to ensure that it is working as planned? And just following on from that, will statistics be published breaking down which elements of clients' awards change following the post-transfer review? So, for example, is it going to be transparent how many people are losing out or gaining from this move? Thank you.
Thank you. So we will consider the effectiveness of our communications as part of our wider evaluation of case transfer, and that wider evaluation of the case transfer process forms part of our wider published strategy for evaluating the policy impact of the devolution of disability benefits. We are developing plans for the case transfer evaluation, which would include a focus on individuals moving from DLA to adult disability payment, and expected that the evaluation of the case transfer process will draw on data from multiple sources, including management information, Social Security Scotland research activity, and qualitative evidence from those who have experience of the case transfer process. We currently expect to publish an evaluation report on the case transfer process in summer 2023, and are continuing to consider appropriate reporting timelines in line with our developing evaluation plans. In terms of the statistical question, quarterly reporting of adult disability payment statistics will begin from the 14th of June 2022. The content of these statistics releases will expand over time, and we intend for information on case transfers and reviews to be included in future cycles of this reporting. Apart from this, we expect to include... As part of this, we expect to include information relating to the change in clients' awards following post-transfer reviews.
Thank you. That's extremely helpful. No further questions.
Thank you very much. I'll move back to Jeremy Balfour for a question. You were typing that you don't? Great stuff. Thank you very much. Finally then, Pam Duncan-Glancy, did you have a further question on this one?
Yeah, very brief. Thank you. Thank you, Convener. And it was just to ask the Minister if he would commit to come back to the committee in a year's time to give us an update on this particular part of the transfer.
Certainly. Open to coming to committee. We had a good discussion on case transfer generally recently, and certainly open to doing that again. Obviously, we have different engagements like we have today on specific regulations, but if there's an appetite from the committee to have a similar session to what we had previously on case transfer, which would include the process that we're discussing today, then I'm certainly... of course, I would attend if the committee wanted to have such a session.
Thank you. I appreciate that. And I'd be keen to follow in from my colleague, the Deputy Convener's points around an analysis of how that's impacted on individuals. Whether that will be available in a year, I'm unsure, obviously, but if that was available, that would be really helpful.
Well, I just refer to my answers to the Deputy Convener, which set out what we'll publish, and, of course... the statistics will be assimilated as time progresses, and be more insightful for all of us as the rollout of case transfer is undertaken more generally, more and more. And of course, I talked about our evaluation report in the summer of 2023, and I would imagine that the committee would probably want to discuss that at that point.
Thank you.
Many thanks. And if there are no further questions from members, we'll move on to our next formal item, which is the formal debate on the motion. And I remind committee members that only members and the minister may take part in the formal debate. And I invite the minister to move motion S6M04303 that the Social Justice and Social Security Committee recommends that the Disability Assistance for Working Age People, Transitional Provisions and Miscellaneous Amendments Scotland Regulations 2022 be approved.
Formally moved.
Thank you. Do any members wish to speak on the motion? Nope. As no members wish to speak on the motion, I will put the question on the motion. And the question is that motion S6M04303 be approved. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Agreed. Thank you. As we are all agreed, the motion is therefore approved. And I invite the committee to agree that the clerks and I will produce a short factual report of the committee's decisions and arrange to have it published. Is that agreed? Great, thank you. Thank you to the Minister and to the officials who have joined us online today. And we will now move on to our next item of business. Thank you very much. So agenda item number 5 is subordinate legislation, and we're now going to consider the Council Tax Reduction Scotland Amendment number 3, Regulations 2022, which is a negative instrument. Background information was supplied to the committee in paper number 5. Are the committee happy to note the contents of this, to note the instrument? Yep. Great. So that does conclude this morning's public part of the meeting. At next week's meeting, we'll be hearing from the Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, Housing and Local Government, and the Minister for Public Finance, Planning and Community Wealth as our final evidence session on our inquiry into low income and debt problems. And we will now move into private session to consider our remaining agenda items. Thank you.